I'm thrilled to be here. And as I look out at this sea of faces, I see people who are media people in the audience. I see people who are administrators. They have giftings, so many giftings and talents, and all those things that most of the charities that are here tonight, we all need very much the same thing. And you can read about us, and you can hear about us. But on the picture that you're looking at right now, I see a lot of faces looking up there. That is a young man who I met in a detention center. And he told me, he said, "Miss Jan," he said, "I'm here, but I want to tell you about my family." He said, "My grandmother is in jail. My grandfather went through the prison system. My father and my mother are both in jail." And he said, "My brothers are in jail." And he said, "Maybe that's why I'm in jail too." Well, you know what, folks? We don't have to settle for that, and they don't have to settle for that either. Because of my background, which I'm going to tell you about in a moment, I have a passion to be able to help the underprivileged child, that one person that has not had that positive family, that one who believes in them and is their cheerleader. They have nobody. And so Dare to Dream recruits incredible people of faith to go into group homes, shelters, detention centers, and orphanages to share their stories of hope through lots of tragedy. I got a little tip from Travis Wortham, who is in the audience over here, who used to be the executive director for the Cottrell House at Dallas Juvenile Justice facility. And he said, of all the years that I've been the leader in that facility, he said, only two of the organizations have stuck with us all over the years. Dare to Dream is one of them. And I'm proud to say that Dare to Dream is now, this actually is our 32nd year. And I started this on a card table in my bedroom without a penny in my pocket, without a family to help me, because I grew up in the foster care system in New York City. I was an abandoned infant that from Greenwich Village, and so I'm still, you know, kind of a hippie. And I was placed in the foster care system, went into a couple of different foster homes, and I had one gift that God gave me, and it was the gift to look at what I did have instead of what I didn't have. And that's one of the characteristics that when we go into group homes, shelters, detention centers, and orphanage, we talk about gratitude, because these young people didn't have much to be grateful for. You know, a great States lady one time said that the future belongs only to those who believe in the beauty of their dreams. Well, for these children, their dreams are nightmares. And again, they don't have to be hopeless their entire life. They can have somebody like you or me to go in and tell them that they do have value and that God has a plan and a purpose for their lives and that they have giftings and talents that they may not even know about. But somebody like you or I could go in there and see the greatness in them and be able to plant the seeds of encouragement that they need to be able to make the world a different place. And because of the fact that I grew up in the foster care system, I had a foster mother who wanted to be a concert pianist, but she really didn't make it. But she knew that she told her foster children, she said, "I will pay for piano lessons if you will be willing to take them." And all my brothers and sisters and other children who were in our foster home, nobody wanted it. And I said, I'll go. So I actually did have the opportunity to study at the Brooklyn Conservatory of Music, and they would have their final concerts, and Carnegie Hall was one of the spots we got to go to. So here's this throwaway kid playing the piano at Carnegie Hall. You know, that's only God could do something like that. And some of the times that I've taken young people, whether it's in Florida or whether it's from detention centers with Covenant House, The Haven, so many of the facilities that house these children who are runaways and broken families and the things that people think that they're just going to be our troublemakers and those are the people that we're going to have to pay for in the prison system. That's wrong. That is absolutely wrong. If people like you and me will get involved. I have been serving almost as a Lone Ranger for over 30 years in this organization. And at this stage of my life, it's time to pass the torch. And that's not easy to do. But as I look in this audience, I can say, you know what? We're going to pass it to an organization or to people who have that passion and have that heart for God and country, and can be able to instill into these young people characteristics that they've never even heard of, because they can dare to dream because of you and because of me. So we do have some, we have four volunteers in the audience tonight, and you might have met some of them, but we do have a table back there. I've written my autobiography. It's a fundraiser for our ministry, and it starts with humble beginnings, then it has the dare to dream story, then it has my spiritual journey, and then it has leave a living legacy. So that's one of the things that I'm doing. I'm coaching people to write their books, and every one of you in this room has a story to tell. And I ask you to document your story. Don't just let it go by, and don't let generations to come know who you are and what God has done in your life, because the world needs you now more than ever before. So come see us. It's Dare to Dream Children's Foundation. Dare to Dream has open arms to you, and really, really look forward to meeting you. So God bless each of you, and thank you for being here tonight.